ready to start. Thank you all very much for coming. This is the first panel of the South Asian Forum's People's Unity Conference. It seems appropriate that we should start with the panel on Sri Lanka, just given what we're hearing from there and given the urgency of the situation. And what seems, especially today, to have been really, we're coming very close to the end of the conflict that's been going on in the north. And it seems like there is a situation where the government army, the armed forces are more or less now able to have emerged victorious against the LTT. So it is a situation of some urgency. There's been a lot of concern about the kind of brutality of the assaults on both sides, and also concern about what will come next in terms of if the Sri Lankan army emerges victorious, what does this actually mean for Tamils in the country, for minorities, as well as for all people in Sri Lanka, in terms of what is the nature of the state that will emerge? What does it mean in terms of democratic rights for people in the country? What is the kind of socialist or left position on the situation? And so I think we're really fortunate to be able to have that discussion today here in the context of a larger conference around the need for unity on the left and a progressive voice on the left with respect to South Asia and its issues. So before I go on to introduce specifically my speakers, I'll just introduce myself. My name is Aparna Sundar, and I teach here at Ryerson University. And I have three very, very well-known people in terms of Sri Lankan politics who've written a lot, who've been active in Sri Lankan politics. So I'll just introduce them first, and then actually I'll give you a little more detail about each of them before they speak. So I have here Rohini Hensman and Rajan Philips and Ahilan Kadirgamar. So they will be our panelists today, and essentially each of them will talk about different aspects of the situation in Sri Lanka, what they see as essentially the possibilities for some kind of progressive outcome from the conflict, and especially they'll address issues around what the conflict means for peace, for justice, for minority rights, for prospects of the democratic organization under the militarized influence in the diaspora, especially people on the left in the diaspora can do about these issues. So I'll start by introducing our first speaker. I had my printer gave out, so I couldn't actually print out the bios, and I had to copy them by hand, which was quite painstaking. Anyway, I have here Rohini Hensman. Rohini comes from Sri Lanka, but has been based in India for over 30 years, and is politically active in both countries. Her research has concentrated on labor, especially women workers, and globalization. And she's been active in the trade union, women's liberation, and minority rights movements. She's also written two novels, which I have here. The first is called To Do Something Beautiful, and it's about women workers in Mumbai. And I read it many years ago, and was one of my favorite books for the longest time, and still is, except I have a bad memory and forget details. But and the other one is called Playing Lions and Tigers, and this is about Sri Lanka particularly, and it's a very, very it's a very sad story, really, about what's happened to people who, once lived together in relative harmony, I guess is the word, although perhaps not quite accurate. So both of them are really, really good books, and both of them, I think this one's available for sale, right? And there's two copies of the other one. Playing Lions and Tigers is available for $15, and To Do Something Beautiful is also, there's a couple of copies available. So I think Rohini will start. Each speaker will speak for about 20 minutes, and then we'll have time for a discussion, and before the discussion,
we'll outline some of the rules of the discussion.
Well, I'm very happy to be here in Toronto for the first time, and thank you for inviting me. I've called my talk Socialist Politics versus identity politics in Sri Lanka, and I'm trying to separate two paradigms of politics which have emerged. And one has become, I think, almost submerged in this period, which I think is, has led to many of the problems. Maybe I should start by explaining what I mean. I'm not talking about socialist politics in the sense of politics aimed at the overthrow of capitalism, but something much more modest, politics which are against oppression and discrimination of all types, for decent wages, working conditions, and welfare. So a very general politics which is compatible with parliamentary politics. Identity politics, again, if we think of our identity, we can schematically put it at three levels. One is the universal level, universal human identity. Then, of course, there's the individual level, our identity as individuals, which is unique. And the third level is certain particular aspects of our identity, which we share with some people but not with others. And there would come things like ethnicity, religion, gender, and so on. Now, the peculiarity, I think, of identity politics is that the first and second levels tend to be almost invisible, like your universal human identity, which identifies you with all other human beings, is pushed to the background. Likewise, your individuality, which makes you different from everyone else, is also pushed to the background. And one particular aspect of particularity is picked up, and that becomes your identity, almost swallowing up everything else. And that, I think, is a very destructive process, both because it eliminates your bonds with others who are different from you, as well as eliminates your individual characteristics and sucks you into a collective kind of politics which may not be you at all. Okay, now at independence, going back to 1948, we had in Sri Lanka a strong socialist tradition. The in Sri Lanka, things were a bit different in the sense that the Trotskyists were the majorities, and those who followed Stalin a minority, but still, the LSSP, which was the Trotsky's party, and CP, were very active in the anti-imperialist movement, more so, in fact, than any bourgeois leaders in Sri Lanka. They were jailed, they escaped, they went to India, they organized in India as well, and so on. So that was one aspect of them. They also worked with workers and organized trade unions, which strikes which brought together people from different ethnic backgrounds in Sri Lanka. And so this was up to independence. Now, after independence, one of the first things which was done by the first government was to disenfranchise and render stateless the hill country Tamils, the Tamils of more recent Indian origin, most of whom were plantation workers brought over by the British. And there was a very cynical political calculation behind their doing this. This was the United National Party, the UNP government, which was that these workers had very largely voted against them and for the left. And as a consequence, the UNP government was a minority government. And it was seemed like a very easy way to ensure a majority in future to get rid of this large block of voters. So that was what they did. And despite the fact that there were, in Sri Lanka's independence constitution, there were supposedly protections for minorities. Sorry. Okay. There were supposedly protections for minorities, but none of these protections worked.
And these bills went through, the two citizenship bills, which basically deprived these hill country Tamils of their citizenship and franchise. Now, the struggle over that was interesting because the Tamil Congress in the second voted for the second bill, at which point Chevanakam broke